Welcome back. My name is Chris, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to enter a vendor bill in NetSuite. So specifically, we're dealing with the procure to pay process flow, which is us procuring and getting goods, raw materials, things from vendors that we then may sell to our own customers or use for manufacturing, etc. So when you look at that procure to pay process flow, the generic form of that goes purchase order, item receipt, vendor bill, meaning a creation of a vendor bill, and then the actual payment of the bill. That's the generic. There's many different ways you could slice that up. You could also add a requisition to the beginning of that process, but that's the basic concept. So if we look at that, we can understand that we're talking about really the third step of the vendor bill itself. And instead of coming at it from a purchase order that then creates the vendor bill, we're going to be talking about it from a standpoint of a standalone vendor bill. So let's take a look at that and get a concept of the various aspects that go into entering that vendor bill. So we're here in the home dashboard, and I'd like to specifically point out, if you look at the top right here, I'm in the role of accounts payable analyst. So if you're in any sort of accounting type role, you might be a controller or a CFO, you should see the navigation paths that I show you in this video should be identical for you. Not necessarily the dashboard and other things like that, but just the how you get to certain locations should be the same for you. If you are in an administrator role, it will look a little bit different, but you can always come to the global search bar at the top here and just put in the paths that I'm showing you, and it will show you basically on your navigational bar how you would follow and find those same paths. So the first thing we're going to take a look at is how do we create the bill in the first place? And really, there's several different ways that you can get at that. So I'm going to show you all of them, or at least many of them. And so you can get a concept of when you might want to use one, or maybe if there's another one that's easier or a better fit for you, you have all those options available to you. So the first one, and kind of the easiest way that you would go about creating a new standalone bill, is by coming up here to the Create New button. You can see right here I have a bill. Now, if you don't have it in your Create New button, you can always come down to Personalize and simply add bill or really any other record type that you want so you can have it available here. So I'm gonna click on that. And you can see I'm now opening in a separate tab the new bill that I wanna create. But before I actually go to that, let's take a look at some of the other ways we could achieve the same thing. For example, I can come over here to the Vendors tab, I can come down to Purchases, and down here with Enter Bills, if I clicked on that, it would bring me to the exact same page, a new bill that is going to be created. So that's another way we could approach that. Separately from that, we could go to the vendor record itself, basically the vendor that we have the bill from. So for example, I have this vendor record open here, and you can see this is with the vendor Optics. And on this record, you see right here, I basically have a little version of the Create New button, and I can create a new bill. Now, the difference between this and this button up here is when I create the new bill off of the vendor record, it's gonna automatically fill in on the otherwise blank bill form, which you'll see in a second. It's gonna automatically fill in Optics and any other relevant information to Optics, such as the subsidiary that Optics is associated with. Now, that doesn't really save a lot of time, so I wouldn't recommend coming to a vendor record just to create new from this, but if you're already on the vendor record, it is easier. You can save yourself a little bit of time by simply coming up here and click on new bill or new anything you want. Let's say you have a vendor certification, you could come in here and click on that straight from the vendor record itself. And then the last method I want to show you for generating a bill is different from creating a standalone bill, but really more the, you could consider the generic path of purchase order, item receipt, and vendor bill. That is a natural way that you could get to a vendor bill. So for example, if I come up here, this purchase order, this is a purchase order that I created with Optics, you can see here, and this one is pending billing. So that means that this purchase order was already approved and we actually received the item from the purchase order, and we're now ready to create that vendor bill. And the reason, another way that we could tell that that was true is if we come down here, we can see that this purchase order is for this ultra sharp LED monitor. And over here, you can see that the quantity in the purchase order was 1, and then the received was 1. So we did receive that monitor that we had in the purchase order. So we're now ready to come up here and click bill. And again, this would take us to a new bill record, which is otherwise identical to what you're about to see up here. The only difference is that because of this purchase order, because this bill would be coming off of the purchase order, it would take all that information from the purchase order and it would fill it in on the bill. So it would put in all of those fields, and you could literally just look at that bill and hit save if, you know, the information was accurate, and you would just automatically have a bill right there. So that is something to think with. That's the more generic path. But again, in this video, we're going to be showing as if you're creating that standalone bill. So now that I've shown you the various ways, let's go to the bill itself. So here we are on a bill record, and you can see obviously the name here and the little logo. And the first thing I want to point out is that what you're seeing here on my screen for a new bill may not look like what you're seeing on your screen when you're doing the exact same thing. In fact, it probably isn't. And the reason for that is right over here when we see the form. So in this case, I'm using a manufacturing premium vendor bill form. And what the form is basically, if you understand, we're creating a bill, which is a type of record. The form is going to dictate what are the various fields that we're going to fill in, what is it going to look like to us. So all of these different things here, these different fields, the way they're organized. So just kind of take an overview image here, soak it all in, and now let's switch the form to the standard vendor bill and notice how it changes. These things are going to rearrange. There's going to be certain fields that are no longer there, other fields that weren't there before. You can see this whole subsection down here completely changed. And in the end, we're still creating a bill. Not much has changed in that regard, but the form, the way we're looking at it, and the various information that we need to put in has changed. Certain fields are going to be the same no matter what form you have. Obviously, you can't create a vendor bill without saying what the vendor is, but there's a lot of other custom fields or just kind of specific types of information that you may or may not have on any particular form or whatever form you're looking at. So I'm going to switch it back to our default form. And one thing I want to point out is that if you're in, let's say, an accounts payable role, you may not have the ability to change the form. Like right now, I can switch it between forms. You may not have access to that at all. You may be locked off with one particular form. If so, that's fine. You might not even see that field on there at all. It might be hidden away. So just be aware of what the forms are, how those influence things. So with that in mind, I'm going to be walking through this. Now, I'm not going to go over every single field, not by a long stretch, mainly because, as I just pointed out, it really depends on the circumstance and what form you have in terms of the fields that you're going to be filling in. I'm just going to be commenting on the key and most important fields that in almost every instance you are going to be dealing with. So starting from the top, we of course have the vendor field itself. So we're going to pull up optics, and you can see I put the little percent symbol, which is referred to as a wildcard. That just allows me to, if I misspell it or if I'm putting in, maybe there's numbers that come before the name, it'll allow me to just look for that keyword that I type in and locate it regardless of anything else going on in the title of that vendor. Now, you may have missed it, but when I put in that vendor, it actually filled in several other fields automatically. So for example, the subsidiary is tied to that vendor. So as soon as I selected optics, it knew that it was part of US1. And there's a few other fields that filled in at the same time. For example, it filled in this memo field with a number. Now in this particular case, I want to put a custom memo. So I want to say that this is going to be a monitor for a new hire. If anyone's come back to this bill, they'll understand what this bill was for and why we were purchasing what we did. Of course, there is also the account. Now, this field, again, was blank. In this particular case, again, because I selected the vendor, it knew that it's going to be going to this accounts payable account and that it can automatically fill in that information. Okay, with that in mind, we can come down So things like the date, that automatically fills in with today's date. And coming down from that, we do have location, and you can see from the little asterisk that this is a mandatory field. So we're gonna come in and we're gonna select San Francisco. So this is where this item is gonna be coming to. And you can see we also have currency, exchange rate, but those automatically filled in, so we don't have to worry about that. We can also see the approval status. So if you've got approval workflows at your company for purchases, you might have rules in terms of certain dollar amounts require approval, certain amounts might not. You just should just be aware of what are your approval workflows at your company and how that works. But this is an easy way to see what is the status and if it's gonna require approval, et cetera. Moving down from that, I'm going to skip this area because this is quite specific. We can come down to the items subtab, and you can see this is where we're going to be putting in the actual things that we are purchasing. Now, notice up here, in this is referred to as the sublist, we have items, but we could also click on expense. So depending on how or what you're purchasing, for example, if it's an advertising expense or utilities or maybe insurance, you can put it in as an expense where you're basically dictating what is the account that this thing's gonna hit. You can put a description, the amount, etc. You can put in that basic info and just have it recorded as an expense. Or, as we're gonna do in this example, if you've got specific items that you have saved in your NetSuite system that you might be stocking for resale, or they might be items that are gonna be used for the assembly of other items, then you're gonna be purchasing these things as items. You can also do both. You might have an expense for $500 and then certain line items that you're purchasing all included in one vendor bill. And that's totally fine. So in this particular case, I'm gonna keep it very simple for this example. We're just gonna put in that monitor that we had earlier mentioned. So we have a few different options here. Again, notice I put in that wildcard percent symbol. That allows me to look for that keyword of monitor, regardless of the fact that I didn't put in computers and multimedia, et cetera, et cetera. So for example, I have this ultra sharp LED monitor, 24 inches. I'm gonna select that. And it automatically gives me a quantity of one. It fills in the amount. And there's a bunch of other columns here. If you notice, if I scroll over, ton of other columns, similar to what I was talking about with the form. All of these columns can be customized. You might have a lot of columns on your vendor bills that I don't have here, or vice versa. So I'm not going to be getting into all of those. The key information is just what is the item, what is the quantity, and what is the rate. Those are vital, fundamental things that you have to have on every line item. So I'm going to come over here and click add. And I've now added that computer monitor. Notice it fills in the amount here. So if I added additional line items, it would take the total of those and it would sum it up here. So I could see, okay, that's the total amount I have for items. That's the total amount I have for expenses. And then those two figures would be added together and then shown at the top of the record as the total for that vendor bill. One additional thing I want to point out for this is I could click add multiple. Let's say there was 14 different things you're going to have on that purchase order, or in this case, the vendor bill. If you click add multiple, you'll be given a whole list of the available items and you can easily go through and click them as opposed to going line by line and kind of following through that process. So that's an easy way to handle a bunch at once. And that's kind of it in terms of the fundamental information. Before we jump off the record, there's just a couple additional things I'll show you, which is, first off, we have this billing subtab. So if I come to that, you've got things like terms. For example, in this particular case, Optics does have terms with us of net 30. Of course, if you had different terms, you could come in and change that. And then moving on, a lot of these subtabs are not necessarily relevant. You probably, in the vast majority of cases, won't touch them at all. But we do have landed costs over here. So, and you'll also see if I go back to items, there's a line here about landed costs. So landed costs, if you're not already familiar with the term, it's all the expenses related from getting, let's say it's a widget that you're purchasing, getting it from the vendor you're purchasing it from, their doorstep, all the way to your warehouse. All the expenses, it might be shipping, there might be fees or taxes related to that. All of those included are considered landed costs. And if you're dealing with landed costs as a part of your purchasing, then of course, you're gonna need that information. That definitely goes way beyond the scope of this video, but I have a separate video called landed costs. It is definitely a deep subject. So if you need that information, by all means, check out that video. The last thing I wanna point out on this record, if I scroll to the top, we have this autofill button. So the concept of this is, let's say you put in optics as the vendor, you can then click on autofill and it's supposed to basically look at what is the last purchase you had with optics and just kind of fill in all that information. So they would put in the memo, it would put in the line items and the quantities and all that. I find it's actually pretty hit or miss. It doesn't, as simple you would think as a function of just pulling the last transaction. Sometimes it just puts in something, certain line items and certain quantities that I've never purchased from that vendor before. So you can kind of test it out for yourself, see if it does save time for you and if it actually is getting close to accurate in terms of at least pulling from previous transactions so that you can utilize it to save yourself time if that works out in your favor. In this particular case, we have everything we need. So I'm going to come up here and I'm going to click save on this bill. Okay, so we've confirmed that we created this new bill. And you can see right here, we're now waiting for the approval on it. So as I mentioned before, there's approval workflow set up. So this bill will need to go through whoever that approval individual is. It might be the controller. And once that's approved, this will go from pending approval to approved. And of course, we could then move on to the actual payment of this bill. Now, if after creation, you actually wanted to go back to and locate this bill, there's a number of different ways you could do it. But for example, if you went to the vendor record, so remember I had optics opened up here, and you actually scroll down, notice we've got this financial subtab. And if we scroll way down on that, under transactions as a sublist, you can see all of the different transactions we have with optics. So, and you can put in date order, whatever you want, but you can see we've got a ton of different transactions with them. And at the top, obviously we have the most frequent ones, but we just created a new one. So let's actually come over here and the page refreshes. So we can scroll down now back to these transactions and notice right here, we have the bill. We can see we've got the today's date on there. And this is the one monitor that we purchased for $238. It appears right there. You can see that it's open because it's not fully approved yet. And if I clicked on this date, I would be able to actually take a look at that bill. I could also take a look at that bill and really all bills in general by coming up to vendors, down to purchases, and then back down to enter bills. But this time, if you clicked on list, it would bring you to a list of all bills. So that's another way that you could find and locate any particular bills that you're looking for. Of course, you could use also search capabilities, et cetera, to track down any particular bills. And that's it for how to enter a vendor bill in NetSuite. I hope you found this video helpful. If so, please hit that like button, subscribe to see more how-to videos like this one, and I'll see you in the next video.